You've overcome this world with love and made my fight your own. I lift my eyes and throw fear aside and sing out into the night. 'Cause even when the world caves, even when the fight calls, even when the war's waged, I take heart. I know you are greater, forever you are Savior. I will sing your
and strangers, the king and the beggar bleed the same. We've all got a sickness, a terminal condition. We medicate it, but the pain won't go away. See the eyes of a million faces, looking for it in a million places. Only one can save us, Jesus.
You are the cure.
Everybody.
to the orphan without a home. We fell into darkness, lost till you found us. You're the remedy we're looking for.
You are the cure.
Everybody's searching for it. Everybody's reaching out, trying to grab a hold of something real.
You are the cure.
Only you can satisfy us, fill up the void inside us. Never been a heart you couldn't heal.
You are the cure
for the broken, the hope for a hopeless world. The meaning, the purpose, the peace that will make us whole. Don't have to search no more. Don't have to search no more.
You are the cure.
Everybody's searching for it. Everybody's reaching out, trying to grab a hold of something real.
You are the cure.
Only you can satisfy us, fill up the void inside us. Never been a heart you couldn't heal.
You are the cure.
Never been a heart you couldn't heal.
You are the cure.
Never been a heart you couldn't heal.
How you doing? Good to see you. What y'all been up?
Red scars deep inside of my chest.
Have you heard? Yes.
Well, good morning. All right. You guys are much more awake than the first service was. Hey, welcome. Glad to have you here today. Thanks for coming out. We have a special guest speaker today. And I know that you are going to really enjoy and be challenged by the message. I just want to say, I want to remind you how to stay informed as to what's going on here at CalTAP. I know a lot of times we do announcements, but we do not announce everything. There is a lot happening. And people complain to me, complain to the staff, hey, we don't know what's going on. I'm going to tell you how to know what's going on. Sign up for the weekly email, our CalTAP Connect. We send out a weekly email. If you're like, hey, I don't do email, we have this right here, our monthly newsletter that I would encourage you to grab one. Every month we publish a new one, and it has almost everything. Sometimes we have some new stuff that comes along in a given week or in a given week or whatever. But that is a way to know what is happening here at CalTAP. Just a little bit of reminder, out on in the foyer, there are some bulletin boards and places for you to get signed up for various things. There's a lot of things to sign up for right now. This first one you don't have to sign up for, but tonight we have our hymn sing. 5 o'clock, there's going to be hymn sing followed by donuts, all right? So if you like donuts or you like doing hymn sings, come on out. We'd love to have you here to do that. As far as signups go, there's a number of ways to sign up to really to serve our community. This coming Saturday is at Arnold Park is their Monster Mash Halloween party, and we've been asked to help serve there. And what's happened is they've kind of expanded. We did a good job last year, and they've said, hey, we want you to do more. And so we need about 8 to 10 more people to sign up to help with the Arnold Park Monster Mash Halloween party this Saturday morning. And there's information, again, in the email, but there's a bulletin, I think, out there in the bulletin board, or you can let us know at the church office if you and some of your friends would be willing to help serve there. Also, you can help serve our community through our Trunk or Treat. It's hard to believe it's October, but at the end of October, we have Trunk or Treat, and we will be serving our community through trunks and through food and snacks and lots of other fun stuff for kids. And so if you would like to get involved in that, there's lots of different ways. Please take a moment and sign up for that as well. If you're new here, let me just give you a special welcome. Say really glad that you're here today. My name is Rob. I'm one of the pastors here. Really glad that you're here. But really, I'd love to be able to meet you. And one of the best ways to help us with that is through our connection card. And if you take a moment, if you scan this QR code that's on the screen or on the seat back in front of you, it'll take you to our online connection card. And we'd love to just kind of get to know you a little bit. We'll send you a free gift, a little gift, just for filling that out. We really would appreciate that. Before we continue our service this morning, I just want to give a couple of thanks and a celebration. Number one, I want to say thank you for giving. I know that churches, we get a bad rap on this account, but the reality is we are very thankful for your faithful and generous giving. It allows us to do many of the community impact events that we do and a lot of our ministries and support some of the things that we do. And so thank you for being a part of that and partnering with us as we help, try to help people take their next step on the journey to Jesus. I also want to say thank you for serving. I know a number of you were here yesterday for the work day. I was out of town for a family event. But so this morning when I got here, I started walking through the building. I'm like, oh, they did that. Oh, they did this. Oh, they wow, they did that. And so thank you for those of you who came and helped to fix things up around here. But I want to also say this. Maybe some of you are like, hey, I wasn't able to make it, but I still would like to do something. You know what? There is still more to do. How many of you own a house or have a place that you live? How many of you live somewhere? How many of you have all of your projects done at the place where you live?
Oh, wait.
We've got two people with hands up. Wow. Yeah, good luck. Just so you know, something's going to go wrong this week because you raised your hands. But if you would like to help, the only way things get done is if you help. And so maybe you're like, I wasn't able to come, but I could come a different time and help. Just let us know. We can point you to some of the projects that still need to be done. One last thing before I pray and we kind of really begin our service, I want to celebrate. I want to celebrate life change. Why we exist. We exist to help people take their next step on the journey to Jesus. We exist to help people grow in their faith. We exist to see God change their lives. Next week, we are going to be able to celebrate life change when we have a baptism here next Sunday. So I hope you'll plan to be here and be a part of that and celebrate that life change. But also, about 2 weeks ago, we had a student in youth group on Wednesday night make a profession of faith. And yeah. And that is so exciting. We are so thrilled with that. And that's because the part you play, whether it's through giving or serving or praying, God is doing great things. And we are super excited about that. Let's take a moment now to pray and just celebrate God and who He is. God, thank you for today. I thank you for this opportunity that we have to be here and to celebrate who you are. It's all because of what you've done. You created us, and you sustained the universe, and then you, in your wisdom, made a way of salvation through your Son, Jesus Christ. And God, we thank you, and we praise you for that. And now, God, as we prepare to sing and then to listen to your word, I pray, God, that you'll just calm our hearts, prepare our minds, help us to encourage one another through our singing, to encourage them, to teach them, to build one another up through that. And we'll give you all the praise and all the glory for it. It's because of Jesus. Amen.
Well, good morning, Caltab. It is exciting to get to worship with you guys this morning. We're going to do a little bit of singing in just a moment. But I'd ask if you'd stand and join us as I read God's word to us this morning. Please stand and join us. I'm going to be reading from Revelation chapter 5, and this is just a glimpse of the picture of a worship scene in heaven. It says, "Then I looked and heard the voice of many angels, numbering thousands upon thousands and 10,000 times 10,000. They encircled the throne and the living creatures and the elders. In a loud voice, they were saying, 'Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise. And then I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and on the seas and all that is in them saying, to him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be praise and honor and glory and power forever. What an amazing opportunity that we have as we join with heaven this morning to praise and honor and give glory to our God. Let's sing to him this morning.
The Lion of Judah.
of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. Live for you. Jesus, a name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. He's worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you.
Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
He's worthy.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Oh Jesus. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. He's worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Sing holy.
Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Holy, there is no one like you. There is your heart and me.
your heads with me? God, as we just sang, you are holy. You are worthy and deserving of all of our honor and praise. You are the Lamb that was slain, the perfect and spotless Lamb without sin, and yet you took our sin upon yourself to make us righteous so that we could have a relationship with you. Cornerstone, Jesus Christ. Help us to put our trust in you and to love others the way you have loved us. It is in your name we pray. Amen. Thank you for worshiping with us this morning. You may be seated.
Thank you for singing together and teaching one another through your singing. I got a question. How many of you have ever been to, whether as a camper or visited, have been to Maple Ridge Ranch? Raise your hand. All right. Yeah. So this morning, we have a special guest with us, Dwayne Blaisdell, who is the camp director there and a friend.
That's right.
That we've gotten to know. We actually moved to the area the same time.
We did.
But a lot of people know you. Some people don't. They'll get to know you. That probably won't be too bad of a thing.
Nah. Well,
but
never know.
But for those who do know you, just share a little about where your family is, what's happening there.
Yeah, so my wife and I, we have a big milestone this year. We are empty nesters now. So we have four daughters. They're all in college or out of college now, which is, you know, you're at that age where, like, you know, you're telling people, yeah, I'm not old enough to be this old. That's the age I'm at, yeah. So I have four daughters, a lot of fun. My wife and I, enjoying life, man. Can't complain.
Yeah, so three are in school.
Three are in school, one graduated. And she's getting married.
She's getting married. Best thing. You're super excited.
Super excited, yeah.
Okay. Yeah. First service, you weren't as excited.
Yeah, well, I was still a little tired, maybe. I was counting the cost, I think, and I wasn't too excited. You know, I'm excited today. You know, okay. Speaking, you know.
All right. So he's going to talk a little bit about camp, some things. I know, hey, right over here, and kind of toward the front, on the side over here, going to embarrass some guys. I know, I'm sure he'll embarrass them, but some guys are up here to do some work at the camp. And so, but I want to just ask, because camp is right here in Owego, south Owego. And if somebody here wanted to get involved in the off season or even during camp, what would be ways that people could serve camp?
Yeah.
Now, till camp, or during it, whatever.
Yeah, absolutely. So a couple different ways. Obviously, we closed down the facility in the fall. We opened it back up in the spring. So there's opportunities. That's what I have a group of friends here from Thompson Station Church in Nashville, Tennessee. A good friend of mine's pastor down there, and they came up last year, came up again this year. They're helping us with some projects, work projects, and getting ready for closing up the season a little bit, covering the pool, that kind of stuff. But in the fall, in the spring, we'll open things up. I know Tom Forsberg in the past has brought a group of his Sunday school group up, help us get the kitchen open or do some painting, and there's always that kind of thing to do. One of the things we started this last summer is we have 7 weeks of camp, and we're looking for teams of individuals, whether it's a church or a family or some friends to come together. We have a house that can house anywhere from 8 to 12 people, and we're encouraging a missions team to come and help cook for an entire week of camp. They have the menu already laid out, all the instructions, just plug and play. And we did it this last summer. It was awesome. And so we had over 45, 50 different people come get to experience camp, but in a very unique, tangible way of serving in the kitchen. So if CalTab wanted to put a team together, come for the week, you know, that'd be pretty awesome.
All right. So, that's great. So just think about that. If there's ways that you'd like to get involved, you can do that.
Yeah.
And I'd encourage you to do that. Let me pray for you, Dwayne,
awesome,
and
man.
Then share God's word with us.
Thank you, brother.
God, I thank you for today again. I thank you for Dwayne. I thank you for his ministry, for his friendship. And God, right now, I just pray that as he opens God's word, you will open our ears, open our hearts, open our minds. Give us the courage to put into practice the things that he is going to challenge us with. And God, I thank you again for for Dwayne and for Tiana and their girls. I pray that as some of the girls are there, they're on, some of them are on secular campuses, and just help them to be salt and light where they are. And just, God, we thank you for just their family and the example that they've been over the years. God, bless our time now. Help us to honor you in all that's said and done. And it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Rob. If you have your Bibles this morning, I'd invite you to turn to James chapter 3. James chapter 3. We'll get there in a moment. I want to take this first couple minutes just to kind of give you an update a little bit about Maple Ridge Ranch Summer Camp. Some of you may know it as El Rancho de Paz. I always like when you meet someone that knows it as El Rancho. They love to tell you that they know it as El Rancho de Paz. It's okay. You can tell me that. I understand. I have an affinity to El Rancho de Paz as well, because that was the name of the camp when I was a child. And so had an incredible summer. We are all about one thing, and that is creating life-changing summer camp experiences. And we take kids from ages 7 all the way to 17 from all over the country, here locally and abroad, to come. They experience a week in the great outdoors. They experience a week without their cell phones. They experience a week riding horses, climbing a tower, camping in the woods. I said earlier in the earlier service, they cook, they eat over an open fire, which that's weird. They cook over an open fire. They eat next to an open fire. All right, when we talk about our words this morning, so sometimes my words get ahead of me a little bit. All right, but it's an incredible, incredible experience. This past summer, we're rebuilding after having 2 summers without camp because of COVID. We had 550 kids in camp. We saw 30 kids pray to receive Christ this summer, which is absolutely incredible, and which was huge. And then 10 kids wanted to be baptized, and they've been vetted. We talked to them, make sure the parents are cool with it, make sure they understood what they were doing, and that was a really, really exciting summer. It's just an incredible opportunity we have to make a difference and make a difference in the lives of kids, families, staff. I love the fact that, you know, just like CalTab, we are a bright light in a dark area, and I think we have an opportunity to continue to proclaim the gospel, and it's been a really, really cool privilege to be a part of it. A couple weeks ago, I went to a conference in Washington, D.C., led by Pastor Mark Batterson. You may have read the book Circle Maker. It was a book I read in 2012. A good friend of mine, Matt Johnson, who grew up in this church, Cal Tab, is on staff there. He went to be on staff there, and he said, "Hey, I encourage you to read this book." And I read it, and it changed my life. It changed the trajectory of my prayer life. It changed the trajectory of the vision I had for Maple Ridge. It just encouraged me using just scriptures and stories of God doing incredible things. And when I got invited to go to this conference, and I asked Matt, my buddy who's on staff there, I was like, why should I go to this conference? He says, he goes, it's a conference for pastors, leaders, entrepreneurs, business entrepreneurs, people that have a vision for something, but maybe don't have the resources, and they just kind of feel crazy in the midst of it. It's kind of, if anything, you just come, and maybe hopefully you'll be encouraged, and maybe you won't feel as crazy. And so I was like, I'm coming. I kind of feel in that moment a little bit, so I'm going to show up. So I showed up, and there was a story that Mark mentioned, and I wanted to share it with this morning. He says this. He uses the story of the woman at the well, right? And Jesus comes to the well, and he talked about the well for a minute. The fact that well had been there for generations, and that it had been dug by somebody else. And he made this statement. He goes, "We drink from wells we did not dig." The reality is all of us in our walk with the Lord, whether it's at a church or a camp or whatever, we drink from wells that someone else dug for us, right? And I thought about that in relation to Maple Ridge, El Rancho de Paz. A camp started in 1955. Bob and Helen Manel names throughout all of the Wego area, they had a property and they wanted to give it to the Lord. And then Dr. Dale Lineball, his buddy, comes up next to him and says, "Hey, have you ever thought about building a camp?" And they said, "No, but how do we do it? Let's do it." And they began a camp. And they began to dig a well in the Southern Tier region. I think about CalTab and the relationship that Maple Ridge and CalTab have together. The relationship with the ranch is deep. The history is deep. And there are people in this church that have been a part of this church at some season of the story that have been a part of the story of digging the well of Maple Ridge and the opportunity and the impact we have to make on other people. I think about Mel Beam. I mean, how do you not love Mel Beam? I mean, he's like an incredible member, like always an encouragement. He was a, he's an honorary board member at Maple Ridge. They did that back in like in the 90s or early 2000s. But he was a guy that loved seeing kids come to Christ, right? He's a guy that loves seeing kids. He had the bus ministry, right? He would pick up the kids. You just, you know, some of y'all shaking your head. You're like, I remember being on that bus. In fact, my buddy Matt Johnson was on that bus, came to this church without parents, that brought he came with friends to church. He was bused to camp, bused to this church. He would bring kids to camp. He would bring them on weekends. He'd bring them to summer camp. He just loved seeing people get saved. And that's just an incredible partnership. I think about y'all as a congregation, how you continue to support us as missionaries, and you send financial donations, but you also send volunteer teams. You send you even send kids. I think about Paul Williams, my man over here. The one year y'all took a big old generous donation, and you just sent kids. And Paul just literally just he went and grabbed kids out of Endicott, just picked them up and threw them at camp. It was just awesome. And they literally showed up with a backpack in their back, and that was it. And we went and had to get them some clothes. It was like, the kids didn't even know where am I? Well, you're in the middle of nowhere now. You know, you're not Endicott anymore, you know. And I think about Jeff Van Gordon, a good friend of mine. I know he's a friend of the church here, and He was the chairman of the board before I became the director. He saw the camp through some very dark, dark days. But yet he was always encouraging. He was a part of the board that brought and invited me to be on staff and to come be the director 12 years ago. And we had some tough challenges ahead. And yet he was always a guy I could lean on. He always is champion for the camp. He's always telling people about camp. He always believed there's a greater vision than what we have right now, and we can continue. And I just think about the people that help dig the well so that we could have a drink. And I just want to encourage you and thank you just for being a part of that story of the ranch. And some of you are intimate in what that looks like, and I can't thank you enough. This summer, like I said, we're all about the summer camp residential experience. But this summer, I had a thought, and it really triggered my mind. And they're not super spiritual stories, but hopefully they tie in, and that is this. We have what's called flex time. Flex time is from like 3:15 to like 5, 2 hours, and the kids can choose what they want to do. But the first thing they always do is they go to the hitching post. Am I right? You go to the hitching post, that's where you buy your snacks. That's where you buy your drinks. That's where you buy lots of snacks. Because mom and dad aren't there, and you get to spend all the money at once. And so everyone lines up at the hitching post at 3:15, and then after that, they get to choose what they want to do, whether it's go to the pool, go play kickball, go play basketball, go sit on the hitching post porch. But there's this one boy comes running in right at near the end of hitching post time. It's about to close, and he's just drenched with sweat. I mean, he's just soaked. But he's got, you know, and he's like, he's a smile and he's huffy. He's still like breathing heavy, you know. And I'm like, and so I see him and I said, Jace, I said, what are you doing? What have you been doing this whole time? And he's like, he goes, I've been playing Gaga ball. I'm like, this whole time? Yeah. Like, so let me get this straight. You for 2 hours have been playing Gaga ball. Now, some of you are like, yeah, I know what Gaga ball is. And some of you are like, what did you just say? Is this like, yeah, so Gaga ball, I'm just going to be completely transparent, okay? Campers, if you're in the room, I apologize. But I'm just going to be honest. It's the dumbest game in all of creation, all right? Like, it's just, like, I don't get it. Like, it's octagon with a wall about this high. Y'all have it in the carpet gym, which we have concrete. And so the object of the game is to hit a ball as hard as you can at someone's legs. You got to hit from the knee or below. If you get hit there, you jump out, you're out. So you have to sit outside, and then they keep playing. Someone wins, yay, yay, and then everybody jumps back in and you keep playing over and over and over again. And it's not like one of those things that like, oh, when I get to powwow at night, I get to tell everybody, yeah, man, it was awesome. I won Gaga ball. No one cares. You just keep playing. So to me, it's like, dumb. But the kids is like the best. But here's the best part. This is what hit me right there at that moment when I saw them just so fired up, and it was this. We have 8 walls, maybe even 6. I don't even know. It's octagon, 8 walls, right? Yeah. I went to school in a week. I'm sorry. Okay. Concrete and a kickball. No cell phones. No video games. No parents telling them what they have to do or not do. They do it by choice. This game, it just was like, you know what? It hit me. I said, you know what? Kids crave, desire, and need to just be able to play. I guess the dumbest game, but it's the best. The next day, I was looking out my office window, and there was, during flex time, there was 20 kids and a couple of counselors heading down the hill to go to the woods. And they all had their backpacks on. I said, where are they going? And they had all signed up to go Enoing. Now, what is Enoing? Well, Eno is a brand of a hammock. It's, in my opinion, probably the best one, but it's okay. All right, and they're going in. So what they were going to do is they were all going to head down to the woods, find some trees about 10 foot apart, put up their hammocks, and sit and talk. Anything else? Nope. Just sitting and talking. No cell phones to distract them, and they're talking face to face. They're engaging one another, telling stories, being creative. And in that moment, I saw that. I was like, these kids are choosing to go and sit in the woods and talk. 20 of them. That's 20% of our camp was going that afternoon to do that. And I thought about that, and I thought about the fact that our kids, it's not like kids these days, it's all of us. We crave community. We crave being around one another. We desire and need to have communication where we're talking to one another and enjoying that experience. But yet, life gets in the way. Life distracts us. And all of a sudden, we get so more consumed with ourselves and what we do. And we don't realize that we have other needs that God has created us for. And I don't know, those two things this summer really struck to me to say, you know what? I don't have to go out and have the craziest activities. I don't have to go out and get bigger, bigger, bigger. We can just keep it simple. And you know what? Because kids still have the same desires and needs they had of all time. And for me, we all crave authenticity. We all crave community. We all crave just the ability to sometimes dream and play. And so I want to encourage you this morning. I pray as you as a church continue to move forward and envision and dream how you can reach this community and reach our area. We can do it together. We don't have to get crazy creative. Sometimes we just got to literally come up to a kid and just say, hi, my name is. And just start talking. Because kids, and we all desire that. A couple years ago, we're going to jump into James 3 in a minute. Don't worry, we're going to get there, I promise. And I'm going to be super fast. Hopefully, I don't spit too much on the front row here. A couple years ago, when I set out to become the director, I'd lined out first 100 days, like the first 100 days in office, right? What are you going to do differently? And there was 10 or 12 mantras, things I learned when in different churches I was on staff at, things I had heard, you know, in my couple years of ministry at that time. And I wrote them down. I'd say, these are things I want to make sure we as a culture embrace. And one of them was the idea, this is from a Dr. Gene Mims, my pastor in Nashville. He says, what gets talked about gets done. Think about that. Anything that you want done, you got to speak it. You got to talk about it. You got to tell people. You know, if you want to be a church that's evangelistic, you got to talk about evangelism. You want to be a church that talks about reaching the schools, you got to talk about reaching the schools. You as a family, you want to do certain things. You want to go on vacation, you got to talk about it. I think about vacation. My wife talks about it. So when it comes time for vacation time, she's thinking and dreaming and she's talking about it. And then you know what happens? We go on vacation. We as a camp, we want to be a We want to reach more kids. We want to see kids come to Christ. We got to talk about those things. We want to do things with excellence. We got to talk about doing with excellence. What gets talked about gets done. The second thing was this. Discouragement is contagious. We've all been a part of organizations. We've all been a part of families. We've all seen things where people are just bitter, negative, discouraging, and those things are dangerous because it's like a contagion. It's more contagious than COVID, right? It's just contagious. Everybody gets it. And you know what? If you've been a part of, you may have been a part of a church that it's been like that. It's not fun. But if you're around it, it can be contagious. Next thing you find yourself being discouraging as well. The third one was this. You got to celebrate the win, but you got to first define what the win is. And so these are things that I would try to, marching orders we as a camp, as we progress forward, I was like, you know, what is our win? Well, we want to have a life-changing summer camp experience. We want to do that by seeing kids come to know Christ. We want to see that by kids trying new things. We want to see kids build lifelong friendships. And we would define that, and we talk about it, you know, because that way when we see it, we can celebrate it. You got to define it. But here's the thing that I realized as I was thinking about this morning, and God really brought this to me back in March, this idea, is the fact that, like, there's a thread through all three of those things, and that's this. The words we speak matter. The words you speak matter. Our words have the power to shape our lives. Our words have the power to shape the lives of those around us. Our words are a rudder. They direct the course of our life and others' lives. Read along with me in James chapter 3. We're going to be here briefly. I'm going to read a couple verses here. Starting verse 2 says this, "For we all stumble in many ways. If anyone does not stumble in what he says, he is mature, able also to control the whole body. Now, if you put bits into the mouths of horses so that they obey us, we direct their whole bodies. And consider ships, though very large and driven by fierce winds, they are guided by a very small rudder, wherever the will of the pilot directs. So too, though the tongue is a small part of the body, it boasts of great things. Consider how a small fire sets ablaze a large forest. And the tongue is a fire. The tongue, a world of unrighteousness, is placed among our members. It stains the entire body. It sets the course of our life on fire, and it itself set on fire by hell. Every kind of animal, bird, reptile, and fish is tamed and has been tamed by mankind, humankind. But no one can tame the tongue. It is restless evil, full of deadly poison. With the tongue we bless our Lord and Father, and with it we curse people who are made in God's likeness. Blessing and cursing come out of the same mouth. My brothers and sisters, these things should not be this way." When I read this passage, I look at my own life, I see several truths that play out every day in my life regarding the words I speak. And I don't know about you, but like I've read this passage so many times. I mean, I've read this probably when I was middle school at South Appalachia Baptist Church. But it's something that literally I've yet to master. And maybe I'm just speaking to myself because this is something I strive to be. I want to be one who's full of blessings and not cursings. I want to be one who's speaking life into people and not discouraging. However, there are times that I don't do that. And one thing I've noticed, one truth that comes out is the fact that when it comes to the words that we speak matter, the first thing I see is that the words we speak come out way too easily. The words we speak as parents come out way too easily at times. The words we speak as friends come out way too easily at times. As church members, I've been on staff at a couple churches. Sometimes we as church members, we say things that come out way too easily. It's like toothpaste. Comes out way too easy and you can't put it back in, right? You know, put it too much. The other day I missed my whole toothbrush. I'm like, I can't put that back in the tooth. That stinks, you know? It's so easy to put someone down. It's so easy to put myself down. It's so easy to say something that's not true about others or it's not true about myself, and I speak it, I use my words, and if I'm not careful, it's going to direct the course of my life with the words I say. I don't know about you, but I find myself saying, "Man, I'm just so tired." You're not going to get energy by saying you're so tired, you know? I'm just so bored, you know? We say things that we just flippantly say, "Man, I'm such an idiot. Why did I do that?" I'll say things like that. Was that true? You know? "Oh, I hate such an idiot." We just say stuff. There's power in the words we speak. Proverbs 12:18 says this. "There is one who speaks rashly like the thrust of a sword." A thrust of a sword, if I'm not mistaken, means death, right? So those rash words can lead to death, Proverbs tells us. But he says the tongue of the wise can bring healing. I pray that my words, I pray that your words are words that can bring healing and comfort to those that need them. But so many times, if we're not careful, they bring pain and wounds. Reckless words, those who use words without self-control. We all know that sticks and stones may not break our bones, but words will never hurt us. We know that's not true. If you imagine, you might have seen me do this illustration before in a different talk, but I think it makes sense. Imagine there's a hallway, and I'm walking down the hallway. I'm walking towards the foyer, right? And on the left side, there's a bunch of pictures. On the right side, a bunch of pictures. On the right side are pictures of all the people in our life that have said powerful things over us, encouraging things over us, made our life fulfilled. And we just, there's the people in our life that we just love and look up to, right? It could be a mom, a grandfather, an uncle. It could be a camp counselor. It could be a Sunday school teacher. It could be a pastor. It could be a coach. And their pictures are on the right side of the hallway. But on the left side, there's not as many pictures, but they stand out. They're the people in our lives that used words to hurt us. Harmful situations, things that we went through, a coach that maybe said, you know, you don't have what it takes, or saw a friend that says, man, I'm done with you, or a parent that just says, dude, what are you talking, maybe it's a parent. It doesn't matter. Just you know you have in your mind who they are. And here's the problem. We walk down this hallway, on the right, all the awesome things in our life, left, all the negative things in our life, and here's the thing. When we're walking, we're looking like this all the time. We're looking to the left. Even though we have hundreds of people that may have spoken truth over us, we're always looking at the two or three ones that cast doubt on us. Because words have a way of harming us. And so we as believers are to be better. We are to be the ones who bring life and to speak truth because we have hope to bring to others. And I want to encourage us as we walk down the hallway of life that hopefully we're putting ourselves on other people's right side of the wall with the words we say. The second thing I see is this. The words we speak direct my course. He says in verse 7, he said, verse 6, among our members, it stains the whole body. It sets the course of life on fire. It sets the course. And consider the ships, he says in verse 4, though very large and driven by fierce winds, they are guided by a very, very small rudder, wherever the will of the pilot directs. Your tongue, my tongue, is a rudder. I don't know if you have ever been on a cruise before. If you want to know a little chief secret, that's what they call me at camp. If you want to know a little secret, I love me some cruises. There's a lot of reasons why you love a cruise. Unlimited food. Pools on end. Chairs. They clean your room like 3 times a day. A little chocolate on the bed at night. You know, a towel folded in the shape of a monkey hanging from the shower. It's just awesome. And and everyone's happy. Like, if you're a miserable person and you're having a bad time on a cruise, that's something's wrong with you, all right? I'm just saying, it's the best. But here's what I love about a cruise. You pull up into port, right? And like in Fort Lauderdale port, there's like 8 ships there. And they're ginormous. I mean, the Royal Caribbean ones are as big as Binghamton. I mean, they're huge. I mean, literally. They dwarf the city of Fort Lauderdale. It's crazy. But here's what's crazy, is that big ship is directed by a couple of little, what they call now, because they're new technology, Ozipods, a.k.a. a rudder, and some thrusters. The ship I was on the last time, we did a 360 turn in port without moving forward or back, just straight around 360. It was incredible. I was like, how do you do that? That little tiny knob on the bridge that they would turn like this moves that entire ship. This tongue in our mouth, this tiny little thing, directs the course of our lives. And we can master it. We can go work out and be like super strong and work on our food intake and all these different things and run and exercise. But man, none of us have been able to master the tongue. And what James is saying, hey, if you got to be careful because your tongue is going to set a direction for you. What you say matters about yourself. You know how you can tell someone's a runner? You're like, where are you going with this? I'll get there. You can tell someone's a runner, because they tell you. All right? If they're a marathoner, they definitely like to tell you. If they're an ultra runner, like, they're definitely telling you, okay? I had a friend of mine back in January who signed up for an ultra marathon, 100-mile race. And I was just like, bro, Jesse, I don't get it. And he wasn't one of these guys that tells everyone he runs. He just did it, right? He signed up for it. And he's like, dude, I don't know. I just have this. I have a goal. I just want to try something I've never done before. I'm going to go for it. He goes, hey. And I'd been running a little bit at the time. There, see, I told you. All right. So I've been running a little bit at the time. And so he's like, hey, if you want, why don't you come check it out? you can help me. You can help me crew. You could even help me consider pacing. And I was like, what pacing? What are you talking about? Well, pacing is like in 100 miles. When you get past like 50, you're like, you're done. You want to tap out. So they let you bring in someone to come alongside as a be an encourager, be an encouragement. So he's like, hey, you can come pace me at mile 60. I'm like, oh, I'll think about it. All right. So he shows up to the race. I decide to go see him off. Glad hand him. Say, go get him, Jesse. You got it, baby. I'm gonna go back to the house and watch some college football. You know, that was my plan. 6 a.m., 200 people start running off to run 100 miles. I'm like, that is just crazy. Like, I mean, the funny thing is you're looking at them and they're like, you got some guys are super fit, and then you got guys that they have a belly. And I'm like, are they going to finish it? I was just enamored by the whole thing. 12 o'clock comes, I'm still there. I'm crewing it. I'm watching these people doing it. I'm with his brother, Chris, who's an ultra runner. He's telling me stories. He's telling me all this about different historic races that people do. I'm like, what are you talking about? I know nothing of this world. And so I said, all right, here's the deal. I'm going to go home, and I'll come back around, hopefully around 10 o'clock, because you'll still be running, Jesse. And I'll crew you. I'll pace you. And so I come back around 10, dark. It's in Florida. It was a cold night. I know that doesn't sound normal, but it was true. It was 35 degrees that night, and it was getting chilly. And I get back, and he's at mile 50, so he's still got 10 more miles. So I'm talking to Chris, and we're watching as Jesse's doing his thing. And there's this couple that comes running by. And we hear the girl say that she's the runner. The other pacer is talking to her. And we hear her say this phrase. She goes, man, I hate the cold weather. And Chris looked at me after they were a long way from us. And Chris, his brother, says, she's done. She'll probably make it a couple more miles, and then she'll be done. I said, what? Because you cannot get to mile 50, mile 60, knowing you have 40 more, and start complaining about the weather, start complaining about how you feel. Because if you allow those things to come out of your mouth, it will literally shut your body down. And I was like, wow. Jesse comes around to mile 60, and I was like, all right, I guess I'll help you for a little bit. I'll go do 10 miles. So I throw my shorts on, and I was like, all right, let's go. And I'm thinking, Jesse's feeling pretty good. So I'm thinking, well, Jesse's just going to run. He'll tell me when we want to walk, when we run, and I'll just kind of be there and hopefully don't say anything stupid. And mile 63, he's done. Like, he cannot make any more decisions. And so he literally just slows down, and I have to take over. And at that point, I realized every word that comes out of my mouth matters, because if I do not want to be the one that messes this up for Jesse. He's got a goal. He's going to finish it. And so I went with him for 7 hours. Start, stop, start, stop. I'd run to get the crew. And it was incredible, man. I kept encouraging, bro, you got this. And we started with these sayings. So, man, we would say this dumb thing. It's not even true, but I would say, man, we never get tired. He goes, I never get tired, And then we'd be like Captain America. We'd be like, I could do this all day. It's 2 a.m, At that point, you don't want to eat anything. You're drinking you're literally just drinking vegetable broth. But he's doing it. I finished. He was ahead 20 more miles. His brother took over. I've never been more excited for an individual than when my buddy crossed that finish line at 100 miles. It was incredible. He said this. He said, if I didn't have Chris and I didn't have you, I would have quit at 50. Here's the truth. Life, we like to say, oh, life is a marathon, life's a sprint, dude, life's an ultra plus. It's probably like the Cocodona 250, which I didn't know what that was a year ago, but now I do. And that's 250 miles in Arizona. Like, who does that? And, life is like that. And we need to make sure we're speaking truth over ourselves and speaking truth over others and to get them to the finish line. One of the things I love about the power of words is that we direct the course of our own life, but also directs the course of others. There's a phrase, show me your friends, I'll show you your future. I don't know who coined it, but I've heard that many times as a youth pastor. I reworded it. I said, show me your friends' words, I'll show you your future. Because the friends you surround yourself with will direct how you go, the direction you go in life. What I love about camp is that we get to come alongside kids. We get to come alongside you as parents, get to come alongside you as a church, and sometimes say the exact same thing, but in a different way, in a different voice, and sometimes they hear us, maybe a little better than you. or we get to plant a seed that ends up making an impact down the road. You know, there's the book series, Harry Potter, right? It's just like this big. It's like 8 books. A buddy of mine, he's not a friend of mine at all. I just follow him on Instagram, so I think he's my buddy. John Acuff is an author. Why did I say my buddy? And he acts like he's a buddy because he's awesome. John Acuff, he did this little reel, and he's like, you know what the 4 best words in all of the Harry Potter collection is? It's when Hagrid says to Harry, "You are a wizard." Harry didn't believe he was a wizard, and yet Hagrid comes to sign one of the teachers and says, "Hey, you have what it takes. I see this in you. You are that guy. You're going to be a wizard." Now, I'm not even getting all weird about wizards, but here's the truth. That was an awesome point. The whole book is about Harry becoming a muggle, I think. I don't even know. I've never read the books. To a wizard, right? In the same way, we get to come alongside people and speak truth over them and speak truth, and we get to be a part of them seeing something they don't see in themselves. We as Christians, we get to inherit the kingdom of God. We have hope. We have peace, right? But so many times we walk around and say, "Oh, I'm such a sinner. I'm such a loser." When you give your life to Christ, God doesn't see us that way. He sees us as saints. And so that's an encouragement to me to say, you know, the things I say are so, so important. How does this play out practically? And I'm skipping a bunch of stuff because I got carried away, but it's all right. When you see something, when you think something about somebody, man, I just want to encourage you to say it. Not negative, but positive things, right? Say it. You can think it all day long, but there's power when it comes out of your mouth. I've never had a student, I've never had a camper, I've never had a staff member, I've never had a kid tell me, my own kid, say, "Dad, Dwayne, will you just please stop encouraging me?" We all love encouragement. We all need it. We all like it. Just imagine someone's got a tattoo across their head that says, "Encourage me," and just encourage people. I'll close with this. In 2017, we started looking for the idea of building a lake, and we wanted to build a lake, and we were praying through that, and we had a vision of doing that, and so we'd start being a little crazy, start telling people. We had no idea how we're going to do it, how we're going to pay for it, but we start saying it, and it's a little crazy to say something that you don't know how it's going to come to fruition. And I remember Jeff Van Gordon, he was chairman of our board at the time, and he was at a church, and someone was talking to him. And someone said, they literally were talking about the future, and Jeff was like, "Oh, we're going to build a lake up there." And this guy literally said to Jeff, he goes, "You're never going to build a lake. That lake will never happen." And Jeff, in his wisdom, replied and said, "You have no right to say that. The reality is that you have no reason to put God in a box that God couldn't do something." Now, the guy was kind of right, because we didn't have to build a lake. God provided 2 years later, 225 acres and a lake, a 10-acre lake, and a house adjacent to our property. And then he provided the $400,000 over a year to actually be able to purchase it in cash. None of us saw that in our plan. There's power in the words we speak. I will never forget, there was a lady in the first service, she had wrote a letter, her kid came to camp my first few summers, she wrote a letter to me. And it said, I'm praying for the Maple Ridge. I'm so excited for the impact that made my daughter. I can't wait for the day. She had no idea what she was writing at the time, but it was so powerful. She said, "I can't wait for the day that my daughter gets baptized in the lake." She saw something I didn't even see, and she was praying. And there's going to come a day where we're going to be able to baptize kids in the lake. We don't drink from wells. We drink from wells we did not dig. Here's the beauty of what we get to do as a church, as a family, as a camp, as those who are followers of Christ. We get to dig wells for future generations. My encouragement this morning, with your words, what wells are you digging and working on? I heard this, Mark Batterson also said this the other day. I heard him say, I was like, "Dang, I'll write that one down too." He said, "Legacy is not what we accomplish. Legacy is what others accomplish on behalf of what we did." When I think of Helen Mennell and Bob Mennell, their legacy, they left a legacy, because we are still accomplishing things because of what they did 70 years ago. We get to sit in a sanctuary from people that built something many, many years ago. My encouragement to you this morning is our words matter. What direction is your life based on the words you're speaking? How are you impacting those around you? I really do appreciate the time this morning. Thank you. I'm going to pray for us. And I'll let the band get back up here. Lord, thank you so much for this morning. Thank you for our time. I pray, Lord, more than anything, that you will be glorified in all you do. I pray, Lord, you would convict us of the times we use coarse jesting or are joking or hurtful words. And I pray, Lord, more than anything, that we look for opportunities to speak life over others. Thank you, Lord, that you see us as believers, as saints, even when times we may not feel it. Lord, may we not speak untruths over our lives. Lord, we thank you and praise you for all that we have and the opportunity we have to do it together. Lord, may we continue to see many, many people come to know you in this region. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please stand with us.
Yeah.
Let me pray for us as we leave here this morning. May our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loved us and by his grace gave us eternal encouragement and good hope, encourage your hearts and strengthen you in every good deed and word this week. In Jesus' name, amen. Your words matter. Go encourage others this week. Have a great week.
With a billion stars, surely you'll light my way. When the road gets dark, I will walk by faith and not by sight. This I know, God is silence every fear with perfect peace. Above all distraction, above every doubt, you have my attention here right now. Love from the outset, yours from the start. You broke through the darkness to have my heart. I'm lost to the world. That never fades, in a hope that never sways. You'll never let go.
This love is bio, bio.
You got me reaching for the sky. Now I'm spinning over, why? You'll never let go.
This love is bio, bio.
Silence with heavenly sound, louder than thunder, shaking
freedom is now. I'm lost to the world, in you forever. Down in a love that never fades, in a hope that never sways. You'll never let go. This love is wild, wild. You got me reaching for the sky. Now I'm spinning over why. You'll never let go. This love is wild, wild.
This love is wild, wild.